today is the 18th day of the 12th month on our Maker's Restored calendar. It was at the dawning of the 18th day of the first month that Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to Yeshua's tomb to find it empty. This day point is 30 days from today. 30 days prior to today, on the 18th day of the 11th month, was the anniversary of the day that the Most High led his servant Noah to let loose the second dove that brought back the olive branch. This olive branch was symbolic of the Most High's second witness, when his servant Elijah was sent to call Elisha to serve the Most High. We are told that he found him holding his peace with 12 pairs of oxen. This is recorded in 1 Kings chapter 19. So he, Elijah, walked from there, and he found Elisha, the son of Shaphat, who was holding his peace before 12 pairs of oxen, he and the 12. And Elisha passed over him, and he cast his garment upon him. Elisha means the riches of Elohim. Shaphat means the judgment. Verse 20, and he left the oxen, and he ran behind Elijah, and said, I beseech you to let me kiss my father and my mother, and then I will walk behind you. And Elijah said to him, turn back and walk, because what do I have to do or to make of you? And Elisha turned back from behind him, and he took a pair of the oxen, and he slaughtered them, and he seethed the flesh of the oxen in a vessel, and he gave it to the people to eat. And then he arose and walked behind Elijah, and he ministered unto him. This event occurred right after the Most High showed his servant Elijah that his wrath was not going to be in his mighty spirit when he sent it, or in the shaking that he sent with his seven spirits that he has put upon me, or in the refiner's fire that he sent me to be, but rather that it will accompany the small quiet voice that he has sent me to be. It was at this time, before going to call Elisha, that Yahweh gave his servant Elijah the prophecy for 7,000 men that had not bent their dual knees to Baal, every mouth that had not kissed Baal. I have been putting more of an emphasis upon the Hebrew grammatical notation for dual in recent videos. I have been doing so in order to illustrate how the Most High uses this grammar notation to refer to his two witnesses. Baal means master or husband. Therefore, the Most High's prophecies for Baal refer to a different master or to a different husband than him. Where are such 7,000 men today? Since there is not much such a number today, the Most High has shown us that this is a prophecy that is for the 7 billion that are getting ready to be destroyed in the days that are ahead. The details of how he has done so are discussed in other videos that are on this site. The symbolism that the Most High wove into this event with his calling Elisha to serve him is extremely dynamic, and how it parallels the here and the now and his servant Elisha's successor at this time. 12 pairs of oxen parallel the 24 elders that sit at the Most High's throne. Concerning these 24 elders and his servant that was clothed in filthy garments, his word tells us in Zechariah chapter 3, and he, referring to Yahweh, showed me, referring to showing his servant Zechariah, Yahweh's messenger standing before Yeshua the high priest, and Satan standing at his right hand to accuse him. Yahweh said to Satan, Yahweh rebuke you, Satan, even Yahweh that has chosen Jerusalem, even Yahweh who has chosen who the chief seat of the scattered descendants of Israel is at this time, rebuke you. Is this not the brand that I have plucked out of the fire? The messenger that was clothed in filthy garments stood before Yeshua the high priest, and he, Yeshua, answered and spoke to him that stood before him, saying, remove the filthy garments that are upon you. And he said to him, behold, I have passed over the iniquity that is upon you, and I will clothe you with a change of raiment. This is a parallel to what happened with Elijah casting his garment upon Elisha after he passed over him. In verse 5, and he said, put a pure head covering upon your head. So I put a pure head covering upon my head and clothed with a change of garments. And Yahweh's messenger stood. And Yahweh and Yeshua testified to his messenger, saying, Thus says Yahweh of hosts, If you will walk in my pathway, and if you will hedge about my charge, then you will also judge or plead with my house. And if you will also hedge about my court, I will give to you to walk amongst those that stand. Those that stand are his special people that became his kingdom of priests. They are his 144,000 firstfruits that make up his temple of firstfruits. But all of these were not yet at his throne at the time that the event of this prophecy took place. This event took place before the Most High's firstfruit harvest took place nearly 4 years ago. And at that time, there were only the 24 elders that stood with the Most High who were at his throne. Verse 8, I beseech you to hear Yeshua the high priest, you and your companions that sat before his face. Therefore, these companions are referring to Yahweh's 24 elders at the time that this prophecy was brought to pass. This is recorded this way because this event with my father plucking me out from the fire happened before his first fruit harvest. And they beheld or they looked upon the wonder or the sign of this man because he, Yahweh, brought forth his servant the branch. For behold, the stone that I have given before Yeshua's face, upon this one stone will be seven eyes, referring to his seven spirits. Behold, I will engrave the engraving thereof, says Yahweh of hosts, and I will cause the iniquity of that land to cease in one day. He has recently shown us that this one day is referring to the day before the hour that he pours out the seven vials of his hot indignation. This one stone parallels Elisha being before the 24 oxen. And Elisha holding his peace parallels the Most High holding his peace at this time with his wrath not yet being in his mighty spirit or in the shaking or in the refiner's fire that he has sent me to be thus far. These 12 pairs of oxen also parallels the 12 oxen that encompassed the brass sea that was in front of or east of Yahweh's house that his servant Solomon built unto him. 30 cubits encompassed this sea. This is symbolic of the Most High's restored 30-day months. This sea was centered between the two pillars, Jachin and Boaz, with five lavers to the left of it and five lavers to the right of it, for a total of 10 lavers. There were four sets of three oxen surrounding it, three facing the north, three facing the east, three facing the south, and three facing the west, looking out from this brazen sea. The 12 pairs of oxen also parallel the 12 disciples that walked behind the Most High's first witness, his only begotten son. It is important to note that Elisha did not immediately continue to walk behind Elijah when he was called to do so. He wanted to first turn back and kiss his kindred. I'll read this to you again in verse 20. And he left the oxen and he ran behind Elijah and said, I beseech you to let me kiss my father and my mother, and then I will walk behind you. And Elijah said to him, Turn back and walk, because what do I have to do or to make of you? Is this just a random thing that Yahweh's servant Elijah said to Elisha? Letting Yahweh's word testify to itself testifies that Elisha did not immediately understand the question that Elijah asked of him. If he did, he would not have turned back to kiss his family. When a disciple asked that Yahweh's only begotten son to first let him go and bury his father and told him that then he would walk behind him following after him, here is what Yeshua replied to him with in Matthew chapter 8 verse 22, Follow after me and let the dead bury their dead. The way that the Most High has woven this admonition into his magnification of his touching the dead and his water of separation statute and his witness against the scattered descendants of Israel at this time is awesome, totally awesome. When Elijah asked Elisha, because what do I have to do or to make of you? He was asking a rhetorical question. Elisha should have considered this question and realized how foolish it was of him to even ask such a question about first turning back from walking behind his servant when the Most High called him to serve him. This is why Yeshua gave us the following set of instructions that apply to the here and the now and is parallel to this prophecy. in Matthew chapter 24. Therefore, when you perceive the abomination of desolation spoken of through Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place or the set apart place, perceive and discern. At this time, let those in Judea escape or flee into the mountains. Let the one that is on the roof come down and not even take out of his house. Neither let the one who is in the field return back to take his clothes. He said these things to put urgency on our need to flee at this time, so that his Father will delight in us. Yet, like with my predecessor Elisha, the Most High allowed for me to dig out from your midst by selling that which I could sell quickly of that which he had given to me to possess. He not only allowed for me to do so, he put circumstances in my pathway that caused me to have to do so. This is because he knew that there was still going to be time for me to prepare for the fleeing at that time. It was over a year later that he showed me that my digging out from your midst fulfilled his Ezekiel chapter 12 Son of Man prophecy. And this prophecy actually instructed me to prepare for the fleeing. Yet when the Most High showed me the abomination of desolation, I put great urgency in trying to get fled as immediately as possible. In like manner, when Elisha turned back to kiss his family, his urgency was still to go follow behind his servant Elisha. He did not let a whole bunch of time separate him from his call. And he no doubt considered how foolish it was to not simply drop his net and follow after the Most High's call. And from there, he did not let go of this call no matter what. Elisha was actually admonishing him when he asked him, "What do I have to make of you?" He was referring to what does he have to make of him if he does not walk behind him and follow after him. We cannot be that which the Most High wants for us to be unless we lay siege to his call and pursue after him, take hold of him. And after a very short delay, Elisha did so. However, we have now reached a point in time that there is no longer much time for you to delay. Time is running out for you to get fled. His word tells us in 2 Kings chapter 2, when it was that Yahweh was going to lift up Elijah with a whirlwind from the dual heavens, Elijah and Elisha departed from Gilgal. And Elijah said to Elisha, "I beseech you to remain here in Gilgal, because Yahweh is sending me to Bethel." Here is what his servant Elisha said to Elijah. And Elisha said to him, "As Yahweh lives, but my life that lives will not forsake you." A literal translation of this vow would be Yahweh's life and my life if I leave or if I forsake you. The Most High's account of this event involved four different locations. The first of these locations was at Gilgal. Gilgal was where the Most High gave our ancestors a king that represented their choice of a king when he rose up Saul. From there, Elisha and Elijah walked to Bethel. Bethel means the house of Elohim. But Yahweh did not send the whirlwind to Bethel. Instead, he sent his servant Elijah to Jericho. And Elijah again told his servant to remain back. And Elisha again replied, "Yahweh's life and my life if I forsake you." Jericho is where the walls came tumbling down when our ancestors passed over the Jordan at that time. At the time of the first Exodus. The symbolism of these four locations is discussed in more detail in other videos that are on this site. It's incredible what these details pertain to. But Yahweh did not send the whirlwind and his chariot of fire to Jericho. Instead, he sent his servant Elijah to the Jordan River. And again, Elijah told his servant to remain back. And again, a third time, Elisha replied, "Yahweh's life and my life if I forsake you." And the Most High sent his chariot of fire and his whirlwind to the Jordan River. But before he did so, we're told in 2 Kings chapter 2 and verse 9, "And it was when they passed over the Jordan River that Elisha said to Elisha, 'Ask what I will do for you before I am taken from you.' And Elisha said, 'I beseech you to let a double portion of your spirit be upon me.' And Elisha said, 'What you have asked for is difficult. If you see me taken from you, it will be so to you. But if not, it will not be.' Elisha was there with his servant Elijah in order to be able to see Yahweh lift him up. This is because he vowed himself to be there and he paid his vow. The way that the Most High has woven this event and this vow into the here and the now is absolutely incredible. He has made turning back to him a matter of standing with his end time Elijah that he has plucked from your midst and sent to you to restore all things. He has done so by bidding for you to vow to him to offer up the head of your separation unto him at the altar that he has set up in your midst and to pay this vow. His Jeremiah chapter 31 prophecy tells us that he will put his spirit upon you to put his Torah and in your hearts and write it upon your inward parts if you will do so. What a great offer! How can you see his servant lifted up at this time if you refuse to take hold of and to stand with the Elijah that he has sent unto you at this time? His lifting his servant Elijah up at the Jordan River with a whirlwind and a chariot of fire was a foreshadow of him sending his end time Elijah to turn your baptism waters into his only begotten son's shed blood at this time. The details that he recorded in the testimony of his word that testify to this are incredible. You have to deny the testimony of his word in order to deny this. Why would the Most High deliver any of you into the millennium to become the planting thereof if you refuse to do that which would cause him to turn your baptism water into his son's shed blood? When Elijah turned back from walking behind Elijah to go kiss his parents, he slaughtered a pair of oxen. Pair of the oxen. I'll put this verse back up on the screen. And Elisha turned back from behind Elijah, and he took a pair of the oxen, and he slaughtered them, and he seized the flesh of the oxen in a vessel, and he gave it to the people to eat. And then he arose and walked behind Elijah, and he ministered unto him. Elisha's doing so was a foreshadow of the Most High sending his two witnesses to give you his bread of life to eat of. The one vessel is symbolic of his witness that he has sent to us flowing into one vessel at this time. The seething of the flesh of this prophecy ties Elisha's turning back to his family in with the Most High's melting pot prophecy that he gave to us in his Ezekiel chapter 24 Son of Man prophecy, and even his magnification of his instructions for us to not seethe a kid of the goat in its mother's milk. His Passover memorial is quickly approaching as part of this magnification. Are you going to remain in the captivity, or are you going to seize the Most High through the wing of the one that he has sent to you per the following prophecy given to us in Zechariah chapter 8, verse 23? Thus says Yahweh of hosts, in these days it will come to pass that 10 men that will seize the Most High out of all of the languages of the heathens will seize the edge or the wing of a man that is a Jew, a man that is of Judah, saying, we will go with you because we have heard that Elohim is with you. 10 men parallel several prophecies that are for the here and the now. And we have already passed over the 10th month waypoint from the one day and the hour that will follow it. Like I said earlier, there are no such 7,000 men that have not bowed their dual knees to a different husband. And as it was in the days of Sodom and Gomorrah, so far there are not 10 righteous that would cause him to pass over you with his wrath by obeying his voice, by being fled from Sodom and Egypt at this time, and doing that which he has bid for you to do. He has anointed me to be his head steward over the chief seat of the scattered descendants of Israel at this time. He has done so through the testimony of his word. The following are his servant David, whom he delighted in's last words, given to us in 2 Samuel chapter 23. All of the sons of Belial are as thorns that will be thrust away, because their hands will not take hold. The hands of the sons of Belial refuse to take hold of or seize the Most High's righteousness. You refuse to take hold of him for who he is. Any man that even touches him, any man that even touches those who do not take hold of who he is, any man that even touches those who do not take hold of his righteousness will be filled with iron and the staff of a spear, and they will be utterly burnt in their place with fire. Take hold of the Most High through taking hold of that which he has bid for you to do through his servant, like his servant Elisha took hold of his servant Elijah, and vow your life unto the Most High in like manner, and be a recipient of his renewed covenant. Seize our Maker in his righteousness. Rise up from your tombs and walk behind the testimony of his word that he has sent his two witnesses to bear witness to. Rise up from holding your peace, or else prepare to be a recipient of my Father and his only begotten Son's Father's hot indignation. Thus says Yahweh's word that is upon his one vessel that he has sent to you at this time to restore all things and to tell you what causes him to turn your baptism water into his only begotten Son's shed blood.